we will give the floor to you just to elaborate or to ask questions for Lutz or to reflect on what he presented, and then we will we'll have another 20 minutes for Lutz to respond, and we will also allow Nahla to answer some of your questions.
But do you want to collect? I wonder, you know, whether we should not make it a bit more interactive, in the sense that also that it shouldn't necessarily be focused on any one of you asking me or making comments, but I think it should also maybe be put to everyone as a group. I mean, obviously, if it's specific to what I said, I'm happy to then answer directly, but I think we should open it up to the group also, the issues to, for all of us to discuss, rather than focusing on me as a main speaker, yeah, if that's agreeable. Yeah.
So I think we will have like, we can take 6 questions, and then we'll allow you to respond, and then we'll take another 6 questions. Is that okay? That one, okay. Yes.
So, thank you so much, and I would like to thank Lutz and express our appreciation of for his contribution and concern about Sudan. And we all know he's got a lot of contribution, and I would like just to let him know we really appreciate what he's doing, and he's all the intellectuals, they know who is Lutz and what he do. What he's doing to help us to get out of our problems. There are 3 issues which have been mentioned, which I would like to start with. The first one, actually 3 things which catch my eyes, they say, is when you say Sudan is a country in search of a constitution. Dr. Ali Sulaiman will say Sudan is a country in search of a constitution. And the other one is a lack of constitutionalism. Yeah. So the lack of constitutionalism. And the third one is we have to look beyond the current regime. We'll start with the third one, which is that's the main problem we have in Sudan. We never had a constitution. We always interim constitution in 56, in 68, 73, and the current one. And we always think of the regime, building state. We never thought about building country and how we can start kind of debate between different part of the country and different people. And the current constitution is the same problem as like the rest of constitution we have before. So if we have to start, the starting point I would say is dialogue, debate between all parts of Sudan, especially the people from Blue Nile and Nuba and Darfur, where they've been always excluded whenever they start making any decision about the fate of Sudan. That also linked to the other issue you mentioned, which I couldn't say is the lack of constitutionalism, which is we don't have this culture. It's just kind of copy and paste. We copied the constitution, the best constitution back in 1973, but it wasn't something belong to Sudan. It's just a copy. And there were a lot of countries that is the same. There is no history of constitution in Sudan. The attempt which started in the 60s to debate and start constitution is failed by the court of Abud and then the court of Nimeri actually. And now when we start, we have to put to focus on our history as Sudan. It's not history in the same meaning of the way the government said, but the history of the Sudan, the culture of the Sudan, the people of Sudan, how they think, and they have to bring them together and put this kind of a work. The last question, which I would like to ask, this is a question actually about the validity of the current interim constitution. This constitution, I mean the 2005 one, it was a result of an agreement between two parties, the Islamist regime and the SPLM. This interim constitution, I'm just wondering, after the departure of the SOAS, how we say this is a constitution for Sudan? Because it was constitution for a certain part of the world with certain areas, but now it's been divided. So is it possible to say it's a valid constitution? Can we talk about reform of this constitution, or there is a real need to have a new constitution because there is no constitution at all? I don't think it could be valid. Is there any article within this constitution which said if Sudan separated, we can do so and so to keep this as one constitution? And linked to this question, the constitution court, you mentioned there's a constitution court, and Ali mentioned it a little bit as well. I don't have that great deal about what the constitution court was. I know in the history of Sudan before this regime, there was not any kind of constitutional court. But if we have one, is there at any point, have they decided that there is any act unconstitutional? Is there any challenge? What kind, how they form it? What kind of guilt they have? So I just need some more information and see if there is a constitutional for our court or just kind of the rest of the things. Thanks.
Thank you so much,
One second. Sorry, bear with me, because I always need a few seconds before.
Thank you. I just wanted to raise a couple of questions about and points about the constitutional amendments of January 2015. I mean, perhaps a couple of points that Lutz didn't mention, but one was the decision to incorporate the DDPD into the constitution, which was quite interesting that the government chose to do this at such a late stage in the life of the DDPD, after 3.5 years after signing, when the Darfur Regional Authority was in any case due to expire after only 4 years. It's now been extended for one more year. One assumes that the main reason for doing this was to send a political signal to please Qatar and to make absolutely clear, if the government hadn't done it already, that this was the only basis on which it was willing to negotiate. But one wonders whether by putting it in the constitution, the government hasn't also, in a way, increased the obligation on itself to implement this agreement, which of course it has largely failed to do. And therefore, sort of, what was the significance of them choosing at this late stage to put it into the constitution? The second thing was to do with the rapid support forces. Again, recruiting tribal militia. In the past, the government could have claimed that if they committed atrocities, they weren't fully in control of what they were doing. But now they've actually gone out of their way to amend the constitution to say that they're absolutely part of the national security forces. So again, now the government is directly responsible for any atrocities they commit. So what do you think was the sort of reasoning behind trying to do that? Well, perhaps to give them full immunity. But I wondered sort of how you see the significance of that as well.
Second.
I would like to start by saying that for me, as a lay person, yeah, maybe you are a specialist or expert in law and legal people, but for me, the debate should be political rather than constitutional, legal, and something like that. Yeah, and even I think that this debate is blaring vision, people vision, and directs them to another problem and deflect their attention from the main problem. Yeah, which is political, which is about freedoms, which is about the culture itself. Yeah, our culture itself. If we don't accept other people, how can we make constitutions? You know, if just I met an institution sometime tomorrow, come some army or officers,
come and overthrow the constitution, the system, and just put the constitution on the shelf. Yeah, and even the democratic people themselves, like Sadiq al-Mahdi in 1965, he just violated the constitutions. That means you are writing papers, wasting our time. I think from my point of view, I don't know.
The point you are saying now, we don't need to discuss the constitution, we have to talk about politics, because it is.
Yeah, my point is, yeah, I'm justifying my problem. Yeah, just a second. Yeah, no, you are lacking patience.
Is that the point I'm asking?
Yeah, my point, yeah. No. My point is, constitutions, yeah. It's constitutions, what we need to discuss about constitutions. The main points, yeah. The structure itself. Details, we are, I think from my point of view, details are very distractors for us, yeah, for political or for lay people, yeah. Because if you stop, even the government is encouraging that dialogue, they're encouraging that debate on constitutions because they are benefiting from it. They know people are going to talk for 1,000 years and nothing coming to nothing. And if they come to something, they are going to violate it. You know, that's why government is interested in that people never look at the main point, never kill the elephant, as Sudanese people say. They stop the shadow of the elephant. Yeah. So the main points I think you have to focus on is separation of powers. Yeah, it's very important people point of the constitution. Yeah, I think. Secular, from my point of view, yeah, the secular constitutions. For Western people, we need your experience on doing that. Just keep religion away from constitutions. Because from the beginning, from 1954, I think, yeah, when we made the first constitution, we keep talking about Islamic constitution. Yeah? See, in the 1960s, we come again to this topic. After Nimeri, we come again to this topic. All time keep talking about what to put religion in constitutions. What constitution are we going to make if main powers in Sudan are going to put religion in constitutions? If you are not convinced them...
I get your point. It's
yeah, sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry for explaining.
No,
the second thing, no, last point. Last point.
Yeah.
The second main thing, sorry, yeah. Yeah. Should I stop?
No, go on.
Yeah. The second thing is how you call it guarantees or how you call it safeguards, yeah, for the constitution. If you don't make that, nothing will work. Nothing will work. That happens. That from your experience now, from CPA comprehensive peace agreement and other experiences, you obviously see whatever you make, whatever you work, whatever books you write, nothing will work because tomorrow. Destroy it, be destroyed, that's all.
Thank you so much, Ken. So, because we said we will take like 6 questions, but everyone raised 6 questions, so... I will allow Lutz to respond to what question you've taken, and then we will go back to take more questions.
Okay, now I take it in turns, all very, very interesting, the points you raised. First one is obviously that it's not about any particular regime, it's about building a state in the country. So I think that's a good way of looking at it and to really ask post-independence whether Sudan has actually engaged in a proper state building process or whether from the very beginning the state has been captured by certain partisan interests. And because it has been captured by various partisan interests, there has been a lack of respect for constitutions. And I think that argument can certainly be made. And I think that's, and the fallacy is, I think, for those who wish to see political change, that they walk into that very trap, that they think, whatever regime comes next is better than the current one, and they will do better by that very fact. Because if you then look at it from this broader perspective to say, well, only if they address that problem, because what a regime has to then do if it engages in the state building, it has to accept that its power itself is conditional. And I don't think anyone who's been in power in Sudan has really accepted that as a basic proposition. And I think that is the problem with, obviously, constitutionalism. You limit your powers. And that is, I think, what is needed. Inclusive process, I think we discussed that. Obviously, the importance of sort of a constitutional debate. And I guess what you mentioned is the various regions as well. I mean, obviously, the problem is, even if you have a civil society debate, in Sudan, it can be very Khartoum heavy. So I think that is an important point. And I mean, it links a bit to what Rosalind mentioned about Darfur. You have all these separate processes now, which are also very important. You have consultations as part of the CPO. You have consultations in South Kordofan, in Brunei. You have the NDA process. You have the Darfur peace process. So, but these are all sort of separate. How do they all link up, especially when it comes to broader constitution making? And I think it's also one of the problems that there has been this fragmentation of so many different processes, and that has, of course, also allowed the current government to compartmentalize and say, oh, this is about that, this is about another thing, without addressing the broader real governance issues that you mentioned. Now, you criticize the culture of copy and paste. I think there's, you know, if you look at constitution making, there's always a measure of copy and paste. And some, you know, Germany for that matter, you know, after they were defeated in the Second World War, there was a heavy foreign influence on their constitution making. But that doesn't mean that there was later on a consensus that it was a good constitution. So I think if the process is right, the copy and paste in and of itself is not necessarily a problem. It's more of how you get there. I don't think it should be an externally imposed copy and paste or by technocrats. It's good. I think it's good to look at other constitutions to learn from them, because it will be difficult to write constitutions from scratch. There will be certain issues you will always have to address, and then there are constitutional models of how that has been done elsewhere. So, yes, I think important to look at the history and culture, but I think it's not so much in the drafting as such, but more like how you design the process. You know, that people have a say, and then also to say, well, these issues have to be reflected. And one of the issues, of course, the role of Islam. And coming back to your point about a secular constitution, well, I think, you know, if a constitution reflects the will of the people, you know, the question is whether there's sufficient support for a secular constitution. Whether or not it's a good thing is one thing, but, you know, that has to be open to debate. So there are various models of how that could be done. So I think there's also, even if you are strongly in favor of a secular model, and if you think that's the best for the country, if that is not widely shared, then you equally have a problem. Because if you say the constitution should also reflect the popular will and should provide a framework for everyone to be happy with, then these are sort of issues you would have to grapple with. Validity of the constitution. Yes, I mean, obviously it's still an interim constitution. There wasn't an automatic lapse. The only issue was that come the secession or independence of the South, whichever you want, where you want to look at it, all the provisions relating to the South have become moot. But there is still an issue about any procedure changes, because there are still some of the transitional, the status of the transitional regions. No, but the transitional areas, there are three areas. Yeah. So that is still open, because that hasn't been fully clarified. So the CPA in itself, if you like, has not been fully implemented when it comes to these areas. So it's not at all clear. I think there are various ways of reading it. But of course, the broader argument, I think, is right to say now, with the secession of the South, there should be a new constitution that you put in place. But for the time being, it's very clear that you have the interim constitution as it is. So, and that was also the base on, or that is the base on which anyone is acting at present. Constitutional Court, there have been very few decisions where they actually ruled against the government, as I said. You know, one was on the legality of the death penalty against children, so that was one decision, and notable. But on a lot of the key issues, such as immunity for security forces, so that has been upheld as constitutional, or the special courts, an issue I didn't mention, which is also very problematic, which is also in the constitutional amendments, giving more power to special courts. So on critical issues, the Constitutional Court has largely ruled in favor of the government. The two points you mentioned, I think you're right. Obviously, if something is given constitutional status, you open up to also a challenge before the Constitutional Court, which will be very interesting to see how call them stakeholders or others concerned, whose rights are then affected by implementation or the lack of it, may then take that up as a constitutional issue. With the rapid support force, I sort of glossed over that a bit and called it the militarization of that, and I said, now you're right that of course they then become by law more integrated and accountable. I think we would agree that that was probably not the ultimate purpose, to make them more accountable. But perhaps I also don't think it's necessarily an issue of granting them immunity technically as a legal issue, because you could, there are other ways you could do that de facto. But perhaps it's more of a broader political message to say in terms of where the balance of power lies in the country, and to say this has a proven, and it signals that shift in power to validate what the NISS is doing. I see it more as a symbolic message. I don't know what your take is on that.
I was going to say that I agree. I mean, but obviously the purpose of both amendments was primarily political, to sort of show losing control and so forth. Although, perversely, the government has, in a way, from a legal perspective, presumably increased its own liabilities or the obligations on itself. But
you're,
I suppose,
right,
knowing that the Constitutional Court is not likely to
pose
any threat, it doesn't really mind.
I mean, obviously, one could now take all these issues up, be very smart about it, and bring challenges on that basis. But as I said, given the history of the Constitutional Court, the likelihood is not that great. So, and ironically then, given that these challenges are not expected to succeed, you could then turn what has legal implications into a purely political statement. So I think, yeah, it's a good point you raised there. Final one, debate should be political. Well, I think that's a bit of, for me, it's a chicken and egg situation, because obviously the constitution making process is a highly political issue about how you govern the country. I would counsel against saying it is primarily or even purely a political issue, because then you sort of relegate the constitution as a document that sets out a framework. Because then you risk again that it becomes whoever is in political power who will then say, oh, that's how a constitution should be made. I think the political reforms need to go hand in hand with a broader debate about the governance of the country, the state building aspect. So, and you're right, obviously separation of powers and all the fundamental things need to be discussed. But I've been shocked in the past when we had a project on law reform during the CPA implementation, how, at least on the part of some countries, there was very limited interest in the details, the nitty-gritty of a lot of the law reform. And I think that is a problem. If you see everything as a political issue, and you don't address sort of some what we would consider critical issues for accountability, sort of the debate on immunity, very important from a legal perspective. But a lot of the political parties, when we approached them, were quite lukewarm about that. I said, we don't see the problem. So I think there is also a lack of political professionalism in ignoring or not taking the details seriously enough. because that obviously allows to make sort of to politicize, as we just discussed, the constitution again. So, yeah, it is political, but I think it needs to be taken seriously, because unless you do that, unless you give it the respect that it deserves, I think there is a great risk that you could just carry on with a lack of respect for constitutions, full stop.
Okay, we will take another six question, or otherwise three persons.
She limited to two.
At least I was it.
Make a comment, yeah, small comment.
That's fine, yeah.
Small one. Small one.
Yeah, thank you for that.
Small one. Yeah, just because
I can't give you a chance now again before we will take more questions, but I promise I will give you another chance to make your point. So we take three now, Fida and
Fida. Ibrahim.
Uh-huh.
Ibrahim
and
Marie.
And
Ibrahim.
Ibrahim. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I have a question about the case of Maryam Ibrahim. When this happened, I would like you to explain, if possible, the reason why the constitution, which was in place in the time, wasn't called to resolve the issue, because I think the constitution clearly states that, you know, the people have the right to choose, you know, the religion they want. So I wasn't very sure how a court could supersede, you know, the constitution in that situation. If you could just explain to us the political background on this.
Right, Ali raised a really interesting question about if, like, the regime doesn't have any respect for the constitution right now, why would they amend it? So I'd just like to see your view on that.
Yeah, we tried. Ibrahim?
I just have one single question, actually. Why, during two spells of democracy, nobody has researched why the people came by democratic election. They didn't put a constitution that convincing to anybody. It was a guaranteeing away the democratic process continuation.
Yeah.
In a way, they are not very serious, just like the professor said.
Okay. So we have the chance to take more three questions in this case. Nubin?
During the Abud military coup, a driver of military tank, in his way to the broadcasting the first declaration of the coup, he stopped at the traffic light. And though he said you're going to overrule the constitution and observe the traffic law, and it comes to the point that is it possible, because whenever there is a military regime, either in Sudan or Eritrea or Uganda or anywhere, then the constitution will be suspended. So is it, I mean, possibility that is to have a regional Supreme Court that is people can refer to?
Like International Criminal Court?
Well, it's not African level, that sort of thing.
Only U.S. will make it.
Okay, good point, yeah?
Clarification.
Yes,
clarification. What I wanted by, I couldn't finish my question because you interrupted me.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Separation of power, by that I meant,
mm-hmm.
Yeah? Of course, three powers, everybody agree that it should be separate. But for us, which concerns us very much, is the separation of spiritual power. That means state from church or for the state from mosque. That's what I mean. If you are not as experts, yeah, or dealing with these questions, you are not going to give recommendation to us, yeah, about separation of mosque from or church from the statement that what I mean by separation, yeah. That's what my clarification, yeah?
Yeah.
And don't worry about us, yeah, because we are not Spring, Arab Spring, yeah. We are not going to fight when we overthrow the system if we don't have constitution, yeah. Because we have experience, we have traditional. Regardless of what you said, that we don't have a permanent one, but we have traditions, yeah. And I think that will save as a system. After this, if we don't have constitution, if we don't make it, if we don't discuss it, if we focus on political questions and we couldn't manage to achieve a copy or draft of constitution, I think we can carry on after this system, regime, peacefully. I believe in that. I don't know.
Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you for the presentation and for sharing with us these valuable comments. And I have a concern that if you took the example of the national dialogue now, if we could look at it from a different angle or perspective, that it might be, I'm just exploring a different kind of opinion regarding this dialogue. If it could be considered as a space to enlarge the umbrella of the social groups or associations that has to get involved in the discussion of national concerns or national agenda. My point is, through the history of Sudan, there were so many areas in Sudan were absent in a very critical time, like in October. Or even in April 1985. Now, with the harsh intervention of and the breach of the government for the rights of people and the conflicts in different regions and zones in Sudan, people became aware of their problems that brought by the government. But the circle of those who are concerned with politics, I mean the politicians or the community, it's going to be tighter, yeah, not big enough to include those people within their discussion or within their dialogue with the government. If we took also the example of CBA in fashion, if we look at it as a kind of historical compromise, it's not a historical compromise by literally. What does it mean, the historical compromise? But it's kind of, maybe it had the greater degree of historical compromises in the recent or the middle history of Sudan. We need this, but what makes constitution something interesting to the people, not just look at it as a piece of paper, that people have to see their interest, their demands, their conscience reflected, demonstrated in this paper. Without being involved in discussion, in national dialogues, I don't mean this one, but kind of national dialogue, kind of national debate on specific issues. Let us say these issues are the national agenda, or the national agenda to be discussed within national dialogue or national debate to reach a degree of historical compromise. Unless we did that, it will be the same vicious circle, and it will be also going from bad to worse.
Thank you so much. We'll start with Nahla to answer the question of Mariam, who was raised by Fida.
Okay, thank you, Ali, and thank you, Lutz, for the comprehensive introduction and presentation in relation to constitutional reform in Sudan. Unfortunately, I haven't got the chance to speak.
Now
after Lutz, yeah. Regarding the question of Mariam Kies, called the ordinary courts in Sudan, or the criminal court, why the provision of the constitution didn't brought up
before the normal court or jury court by the lawyers. Unfortunately, this is the case in any human rights violation case before the criminal court. The judges are bound by the laws, where the constitution itself, the constitution provision where Lutz earlier mentioned that the constitution provisions are short, there are more shortcomings in the provisions, which is are not in conformity with the international standards or international agreements, treaty that Sudan bound. So if you raise, as a lawyer, I practice law in Sudan, if you raise the question about the constitutionality of a provision before the court and the rights that protected by the constitution, the judge would say, even the constitution say according to the law, which is this is the limitation of the rights being given according to the Bill of Rights being taken by the laws in place. So you cannot. Also, I think the next step for the lawyers, which is I think also they are going to do in the future, I don't know when, but they are going to challenge the Article 126, the article before the Constitutional Court. In regard to Tahir, what you mentioned, the national dialogue and to engage the civil society and the people of Sudan on constitution reform or review. Unfortunately, I think it's not about the will of the civil society or the people of Sudan or to engage in such debate. If you notice, you were in Sudan and you noted that this movement of large group of civil society engaged in constitution making. But unfortunately, the government felt that the impact of such kind of awareness between engaging the grassroots, which is this, the constitution making initiative actually reached all over Sudan, all the states, Blue Nile, South Kordofan, many areas. But unfortunately, the government oppressed the civil society who are working on such kind of work. Many organizations being closed and shut down, people arrested, people, they don't have the right to hold meetings, and you know, you have to obtain a permission from the national security. And this is, in most cases, people, they, or the civil society organizations, they cannot obtain that permission unless they do it in closed places or, you know, closed debate. So the exclusion of people from the debate about the constitution, it's also a kind of violation of people's rights by the government itself. So this is an issue, if I understand, or I understood your question.
A bit, no problem. You can continue. I think now we left with no good question, which is about having a specific court, regional or international, regional court, I think you mentioned, that can guard the constitution. And then we have a rich question.
Yeah. Well, that would be the International Constitutional Court, but unfortunately there is no such thing. But if there is a violation of the constitution, it depends really whether it violates any rights that are recognized in some other treaties that Sudan is bound by. Now you have the AU African Union Charter, which is quite interesting because it touches upon issues of sort of unconstitutional change of government. So, but that was only introduced in the early 2000s. So what happened in 1989 under the current situation would certainly go against the AU laws. But again, that would then be part of a political process. You have the African Commission on Human and People's Rights that protects certain rights. And obviously, Mariam's case is pending before that. So there is a challenge of the compatibility of the rights with the African Charter, but not the Constitution. Even though, say, if a regional body says, no, you Sudan by doing X, Y, and Z violated these rights, because the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, says the rights are part and parcel of the Bill, then it should also mean they are unconstitutional. But in Mariam's case, no one has challenged them before the Constitutional Court. It could be argued, because there is also an issue, but it's quite technical, whether the actual provision that deals with the right to religious freedom in the Constitution is actually in conformity with Sudan's treaty commitments. And the Bill of Rights is a bit odd in the sense, because it incorporates all the treaty commitments that Sudan has, but then sets out the rights separately. And sometimes they're not in line. So, but the Constitutional Court has not really dealt with these intricate questions yet. There has been talk bringing it before the Constitutional Court. Now, of course, the crown of apostasy has been changed, actually, has been even broadened further in recent legislative amendments in February, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So that could also be challenged. Maybe couple of more points. The one thing is about sort of people's will needs to be reflected in the Constitution. Ideally, yes, sure. The more, the better. But I think even there one needs to be careful, because a constitution, at the end of the day, is a piece of paper. Now, it's a document that reflects the outcome of constitution-making processes. And obviously, it's very important the nature of the process and how that influences the paper. But if you don't have the institutions in place, if you don't have respect for the constitution, then that won't work. Even if it's great on paper. And I think if you look at a lot of constitutions that have stood the test of time, is where the various government bodies have had respect for the constitution, be it because there are strong constitutional courts, be it that the parliaments have very strong self-controlling mechanisms to make sure that things are done according to the constitution. So a lot of them is actually in the implementation of the constitutions. And I think people do then recognize that if the constitutions are the basis for a working political system, it may not be ideal. I mean, there are hardly any ideal political systems, but one that is broadly sort of acceptable or that serves people well. I think that's also the respect, that's where the respect for constitutions come from. So I think one thing is to have a good document, but also is whether that can then be implemented by the actors. And that's the big challenge in Sudan. And I think that's why both need to go hand in hand. That's what I said. And that's a political question, but I think you can't divorce that from the very special nature a constitution has, and also what it's meant to serve for a country. And the final point, separation church and state. I mean, all I said is that this is an issue that needs to be discussed fully, because and even if I agree with your position, there is a problem if a large majority of people, or majority of people in Sudan, do not agree with that. Then how do you deal with that?
War. There is nothing other than war can solve that problem. If you are not accepting me as a religion, that's only war.
No, but all I'm saying is there are various, they also, constitutionally speaking, there are various ways of how you can address that. There's not necessarily black and white. So all I'm saying is it has to be recognized that this is a crucial question, but I don't think there is a clear solution. A secular constitution would be a clear solution. But the problem is if you don't have support for that, then you would have war either way. So maybe you need to find a way out there to have a solution that accommodates these different views. I'm not advocating anything here, any particular course of action. I'm saying that's a part of the constitution-making process. And also, you know, because if you have people, oh no, we need to have a secular, we need to have a Sharia, if these are the positions, you know, and if you are not willing to accommodate, then also you have a problem in the very process. And that needs to be factored in, these things. And obviously it's a crucial question, I agree with that. But the process itself has to address how that is actually then dealt with in the constitution, I think.
The question is why the government amended the constitution if it is not.
That was for you.
Yes,
I think it's important actually this, you know, your own professional views about the recent amendment, the 3-1, centralization and constitutionalization of the militia. And you know, this you didn't say what you think is unconstitutional, your own take as a professional in this area, because this is a very major amendment and has got a lot of effect. And I think it's a reaction for what happened, because some of the government they used to exercise his power when they elected. Now the president has the power to do that himself. He can appoint people. And also the militia and the change of the security as a part of the constitution, the resources have been changed. I just as a professional, how do you look at it? Is it constitutional? Is that something people could challenge that you can't just deal with what happened today and change the constitution because you have majority of 90% or whatsoever and whether it's compliant with the procedure? So I just need, if it's possible, just your own views.
There's already some point being mentioned about why the government is amending the constitution now, why it's not bound by any, even their own laws. So why they are amending the constitution? What's mentioned by Roldan, I think it's very...